Hi. You guys didn't actually realize you were coming to a philosophy conference, did you? It's just disguised as a luxury conference. We're asking things like, what is luxury? What is authenticity? What is integrity? What is glamour? What is the store? What is the store? Well, you know, I think in a after a Black Friday, which saw sales drop apparently 11% in bricks and mortar stores, and then a Cyber Monday that broke every single record and rose 27%, it's a fair question. I don't really know the answer. Is it entertainment? Is it window? Is it a museum? Is it a party? However, our next panel probably does. I'd like to welcome to the stage Karen Katz, the chief executive of Neiman Marcus, which has 41 stores. It's okay, you guys, come on. 41 stores. That's my turn. Carlos Jereissati, the chief executive of Iguatemi, the biggest luxury mall group in Brazil, and Federico Marchetti, the chief executive of YOOX Group, which powers three of its own sites as well as 37 other luxury brand sites. So, we'll start with the big question.
How do we follow Louis and Francesco? Yeah.
You do your best.
It's gonna be boring.
Come on, tell us your web secrets. What is the store? What is the purpose of a store in a world where people buy online, people buy on their phone? Define it for me. Carlos, start.
Yes, it's a tough question because I think we have to interpret the needs of and anticipate the needs of our customers. So we have to be much more than just a store nowadays. We have to, you know, to have so many activities. You know, in our case, I mean, in Brazil, you know, when I started, we were mainly the stores. Now we have to have fitness centers. We have to have event spaces. We run a lot of stuff put together in order to be able to attract the same customer that in the past would just come from looking for the stores. Nowadays, they look for the whole experience. So it's a much more, we have to have a much more understanding of every point of people's needs during lifetime, so to make it them to come and to shop with us.
Karen?
Well, I think that the experience for the customer is something that's very fundamental to everything we do at Neiman Marcus and Bergdorf Goodman. I think that the experience has evolved since e-commerce has come into being and since digital and the way people interact via their phones. I think that has changed the way customers think about their shopping experience. But at the heart of what we do every day is to make sure that when they come into our stores or they, you know, type into neimanmarcus.com, that they feel like they're getting a really unique experience, curated merchandise. You know, our stores are filled with beautiful art that we have in this amazing art collection. We have over 5,000 pieces of art in our art collection. So when they come into our stores, it's part the experience of being surrounded by beautiful art. Obviously, beautiful product is so important. And then interacting with our sales associates who are really there to develop relationships with the customers. So I think that is still extremely important to the luxury customer. And then you have to add in how the digital world has changed how they interact with us.
Mm-hmm. Speaking of digital, Federico.
You know, I founded YOOX 15 years ago, so like quite a long time ago. And not having a technology background, I always felt I was a kind of a shopkeeper. So like I always thought that it was a shop. And also in the digital shop, you need to give emotions in the end. So like it's not that different. There are like things are different, things are the same, but emotions, entertainment is the same. Because you need to entertain. They do the windows for Christmas. We do our window for Christmas. And the windows, they have the same, more or less the same goal. So like, and also the name of YOOX is coming from, like the name of YOOX is coming from Y and X, which are the chromosomes. So Y, XX, XY, so men and women. So like the humans and with the zero of the binary code. So it's the DNA of technology, but with a human touch. So like that was the original idea. And I'm still doing in that way.
But talk a little bit about how online fits together with bricks and mortar or exists without bricks and mortar, because, I mean, if people are doing the bulk of their purchases, you know, on technology devices or a significant chunk of their purchasing on technology devices, and Federico, you have some extraordinary figures about that. What are they doing in the, like, in the giant edifice that costs a huge amount of money, right? There's a lot of CapEx. Karen,
I'll start.
I'm looking at you.
You know, I think that the customer today, there's no question she's changed the way she shops, and digital is an important component in the way she shops, but it has not taken her away from the store. I think that in many ways, the websites and what we do through social media has drawn her into the store. I mean, we're lucky. We're not selling commodities. We're selling luxury goods. And there's a touch and a feel and a smell and a taste that comes along with selling luxury goods. Some of that can be achieved in an e-commerce environment. A lot of it is, you know, maximized when a customer can come into the store using, you know, they've researched on NeimanMarcus.com or BergdorfGoodman.com, but then ultimately they've come into our store because they really want to have the experience, the full experience. Mm-hmm. I mean, e-commerce is very important to our business. It's almost 25% of our total business, so it's not that we are not paying close attention, because we are, but I think that these two channels are merging in a way that no one could have ever imagined 14 years ago when we started in the e-commerce business. Mm-hmm.
Carlos, you?
I think technology helped our business to change, to evolve. You know, in many ways, I mean, we, like I mentioned, we have to go to so many activities to bring people in, and we're responsible to really put the traffic inside our properties. And I think we use many ways, even technology. We're learning a lot to use, you know, how to communicate our customers better and better using the social media, you know, all the sites that are available to us to reach out to the customers. And we, even when they come in to our properties, we are able to now, through our app, to really, you know, if they download the app, then they have the free Wi-Fi, and we can follow that customer and really understand his way around the mall. Mm-hmm. So we know where he's going, what he's doing.
You can follow them as they walk around the mall?
We can follow their device. No, and if they don't have the app, then we know that there's the amount of people who are there. If we know that they have downloaded the app, we know who they are. So we are using technology really to, but they know, you know, and help us to understand what our customers want when they are there. So yeah. And we can communicate with them, give them what they want in terms of promotions and things like that.
Mm. And Federico, I mean, you clearly work with a number of brands that have, you know, huge bricks and mortar flagships all over the world, and you handle their e-commerce. Do you think the two drive people to each other or take people away from each other?
No. I think there are, like, definitely synergies. Mm. In the last couple of years, they've been talking a lot about omni-channel, cross-channel, multi-channel. So, like, this channel.
A lot of channels.
And, they say that there is an influence of the web also on the sales in the store, around 50%, I've read, like, these are big consulting firms. But again, we're working on this cross-channel with the brands on their flagship stores, so putting together the online flagship store with the flagship stores since a couple of years. So we've already rolled out some of them, and there's much more to come. Mm-hmm. But I really think that, again, it's a question of entertainment. So, like, you really need to put the customer in the center, because otherwise it's so complex, the processes, the technology, the systems, the invoicing, the returns, that you can get lost. If you put the customer, that you wanted to give the customer, like, a great experience and like an entertaining experience, because in the end it's about entertainment. Also, like, I've been in stores because I'm in a hybrid model. So I'm online, offline. So I shop online, I shop also offline. And I've been in stores, and I think the biggest disappointment is when you don't find the size. And it's very common. I mean, it happened to me so many times. And so, like, the cross-channel basically serves this purpose, because if you don't find the size in the stores, you can go online, where you can find the biggest store in the world of the brands. Mm-hmm. So no disappointment equal to entertainment in the end.
Okay, I want to read you something sort of sparked by that. Shopping has become a form of entertainment. Shopping is a trip. Shopping is a giggle. It's half like going to a good party, half like going to a friendly museum. People want to be loved when they buy their clothes. Does anyone have any idea where that came from? Scruples. That literary classic, 1978. So between now and then, nothing's changed? Shops still form the same function?
I mean, I think that women shop because it's part of their social makeup, and that's the way they, you know, spend time with friends. Mm. They, you know, end up in our shoe salons and, you know, in our stores across the country. And I think it's always been a form of entertainment. I think now, as Federico said, it's all being brought together by their, you know, devices and how they exchange photos, how they post things to Instagram, how they're texting, you know, each other, as Iris said, across the dinner table or in separate fitting rooms. Mm-hmm. I think it's just evolved from what it was, you know, decades ago to just being in, you know, a digital environment.
But doesn't that change how you think about the environment you're creating? I mean, whether it's physical or digital, like the fact that people are using it in these different, you know, similar but different ways. So how has it, you know, how has that affected?
It's changed dramatically the way we do business. I mean, 3 years ago, we made the decision to give all of our 5,000 sales associates in all of our stores around the country their own iPhones, because the customers were demanding that they wanted to communicate with their sales associate via text or email. And so, you know, you roll forward 3 years. I've been spending, you know, the last couple of days in our stores in South Florida, and it's amazing what our sales associates are doing. I mean, they're using Instagram to introduce customers to new product. The customers are sending their Instagrams, things that they found on the blogs they're reading, the social media. And so it's connected them through, you know, digital to develop deeper relationships and thus, you know, be able to do more business with our customers.
Yeah, I think the real change happened with the smartphone, personally. I think it's at the crossroad of all the multi-channel experience, because without the smartphone, it was not possible to do what is possible now. And so like, because before with the desktop, it was like a completely separate experience. Now with the mobile, I mean, we do 50% of traffic.
Mobile's how much? 50% of traffic for you?
So like, and 5 years ago was almost zero. I mean, like 5%.
And so where is it going?
And it's growing every day, every month. So like, so 52, 53, 54.
So, I mean, can you imagine a world where 80% of purchases are made on a phone? And then what does it do to you? Like, if you're shrinking your store to that.
I'm talking only online. So 50% of online.
Right.
Yes.
I know, but if you're shrinking, even if your computer is like that, then you're shrinking it to that. It's a big difference in terms of how you know, communicate visually. Right?
Yeah.
I mean, does it change anything? Does it change design? Does it change? Carlos, anybody?
Yeah, I like what you mentioned about the article that you read. I think shopping is fun, and we have to make it really nice to people. So if we do that, you know, people, like, especially we Latin people, if you think Brazil, a tropical country, people loves to be outdoor. You know, the reason people go shopping is the reason to go out. They want to be there, you know. For example, for us, 40% of our sales are impulse buying. You know, people are there, and they don't plan to buy anything, but because they went to that environment for many different reasons, they end up buying something. So I think that if we're able to create this really nice environment, I mean, we're always going to be having customers, and people are going to come back. So I think that that's how we are struggling ourselves to take technology in our advantage to do, you know, things like I mentioned, to really understand the customer more and more, and to provide them with a really good experience.
So here's another question. If you are devoting more space to entertainment, connections, the experience, art, that is space you're theoretically taking away from product, right? So you're giving more of your square footage to the experience and less of it to the stuff.
Not necessarily.
Selling.
We have expanded a lot. I mean, the size of our properties, I mean, if you take 30 years ago, 20 years ago, was we had a third of the size we have today. So I think we're evolving, especially when I think about the malls and then to mixed-use properties, to add a lot of new areas. I mean, we are building in São Paulo a live theater of 1,000 seats, you know, because we wanted to bring the best plays to the where we are. We have, I mentioned, we even bought and developed a house because we have very high-end customers that they realize they don't want to be in big parties. They don't want to be in corporate parties. They wanted to be in dinners with friends that they know, and then they can exchange what they like. So we it's the house we built besides Iguatemi. It's in W Magazine this month. In the WR, so you can see that. So it's by doing those different things that you provide a real experience to different type of customers, and you really bring them in and continues to, you don't lose the rational thing, which is the shop that you need to have, all the products that you need to have, but you add a lot of stuff that really brings, you know, the new customers and make it fun and live and entertainment, your retail space.
I mean, Karen, you're about to, you've announced plans to build a Neiman Marcus in New York, the first ever.
Right.
That's good news.
Right.
You're redoing Bergdorf Goodman. You know, what are you thinking about in those two initiatives? You know, how are you measuring this?
I do think that the technology is becoming such an important part of how we think about building a new store. I think the challenge that we have as retailers is that the technology, and Federico said this earlier, the technology is coming so fast towards us. It's trying to select which technologies are going to be right for our customers. And so as we're thinking about, you know, the renovation we're doing at Bergdorf's or building the store in Hudson Yards, it's trying to anticipate what the technology is going to be like in a year, 2 years, 3 years. And that's not easy. I think it has made all of our jobs much more complicated. But at the end of the day, when you're building stores, you want to build beautiful environments. Mm-hmm. They have to have, for us, beautiful art, of course, beautiful product, wonderful amenities, whether it's restaurants, you know, places that add to kind of this social environment that is shopping. Mm-hmm. And then I think we have to figure out how does the digital world kind of weave into this. I mean, we have all kinds of tests going on. We have in three of our stores what we're calling magic mirrors, these mirrors in our fitting rooms, mm-hmm. where the customer can try on clothes. She takes pictures, the camera in the mirror takes pictures of the clothes she's in. It saves all of her outfits so that she, instead of retrying on the clothes, she can go through this kind of stream in the mirror. So we're trying many, many different kinds of new technology to try to figure out what are the ones that are going to be the ones to bet on in the future.
You have to be careful not to take a picture while you're changing.
Yeah, while she's changing, exactly. We have laws against that.
Yeah, see, I knew we were going to get to sex somewhere. Yeah. Federico, I mean, clearly this is a different issue for you online, where you effectively have limitless amounts of space. So how do you incorporate entertainment and other distractions in your shopping spaces?
No, I see it like, it can have multiple forms. So for example, on YOOX.com now, there is a Christmas dinner in Venezia. Now we play a lot on the Italianness. Italians are entertaining, as you know. So sometimes a bit too much, but like, let's say that on a positive aspect, it's good to play on the furniture, on the Murano glasses, on Mr. Cipriani. Inviting at the table all these Italian people and also like some American international people, mm-hmm. and everything is a shoppable dinner, for example. So it's a shoppable dinner. So like, which is, I mean, it's a window. It's the window of Bergdorf. The window is for us is this one, mm-hmm. or art. So when Murakami makes us 200 pieces only for YOOX.com, it's not a business. But it's a way to entertain our customers. So now, like, we have art at YOOX as well, and we have hired Francesco Bonami. And so, for example, now with him, we just launched a project, which I think is going to be very, very much fun. Maybe it's an insulting project for the world of art, but I think for the customer it would be fun.
Art does not equal luxury.
And no, like basically he's asking, in the, as a curator, he's asking like amateur artists to send to him and to us their pieces of art, what makes them happy, and he's gonna basically select the best ones. So it's rather than user-generated content, we're gonna do user-generated art. Mm-hmm. Which, I mean, it's just entertainment. And actually for this conference, I was on the plane, I was thinking how to conceive a new world, no? Because like something that puts everything together, no? Like, and entertainment, which I feel myself as an entertainer, a shopkeeper and entertainer, no? And so like entertainer and e-tailer. So entertainer.
What do you guys think? Entertainer? Good, good.
Retailment.
Yesterday I've done the trademark.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
Yeah. Are you an entertainer?
I wouldn't claim to be an entertainer. I'll leave that to Federico.
Nice, no?
I do think, though, that you raise a good point. I do think that people want to be engaged in things, and I think this way of them, you know, sending in their art and how they can be creative and, you know, interfacing that in your website. I think those are the kinds of ideas people are thinking about today, and if you can do it in a seamless way in our websites, I think that people are attracted to those kinds of things.
Do you do anything like that on neimanmarcus.com?
Well, I mean, we're constantly, you know, doing things like, I think last prom season, you know, for girls going to proms, we asked them to curate, you know, the perfect prom outfit, to put the dress and the shoes and, you know, for merchandise on the site and, you know, send it in, and we had a contest around that. Obviously, we use Ken Downing, who's our fashion director, constantly to talk about, you know, with customers the kinds of things that they're interested in and how he can play a part in all of that. So it's an important part of how we're all doing business today.
Carlos, same for you. I mean, other than tracking people around the store, is it same for you?
Yeah, you're going to remember that.
Yeah,
I mean, you know, we are learning. We're learning to use this technology. I think in the end, I fully agree with Federico. Yes, it's really, I mean, I think we are these entertainers. More and more, I think, when I was finished business school and started to work, you know, we had this mission and 100 words. And nowadays, I just think that, you know, we have to make our customers happy. Yeah. And we have to use any thing that is out there to make it work. Mm. So you know, in many ways, I mean, if it could be technology, it could be, you know, the other activities, it could be live theater, the fitness center, and provide good service to them and a beautiful design in terms of, you know, how we design our malls. I mean, we're very careful on that. More and more, I think people have this amazing sense, especially if you think about luxury customers. They really want a very nice environment where to shop. That's why I mentioned we even built a house, and now we're creating a special plaza for the kids, you know, with a very high-end architect, Brazilian architect. So we really want to do this. With the content, the same. We have to have the best products available, both international retailers and Brazilian ones, to make this mix in terms of marketing services. So I think that we have to have broad ways of making that happen.
And one of the things we talked about this morning was the kind of tension between, you know, remaining exclusive, remaining special, and growth, you know, and sort of globalization. How do you deal with that in terms of stores? You know, how do you make each store feel special when there are 41 Neiman Marcuses and, you know, numerous Bergdorf Goodmans, and there you've got 20 malls? How do you balance that?
There's only one Bergdorf Goodman. Sorry.
There's only always one Bergdorf Goodman.
I mean, I think that's a challenge. I think that, you know, we're lucky we have 41 Neiman Marcus stores, and not like some retailers who have 4,100 stores that they have to try to figure out how to have a unique shopping experience for their customers. But I think we spend a lot of time thinking about that. I think at the end of the day, it comes down for Neiman Marcus to two really key things. One is, as I said earlier, beautiful product, a wonderful assortment of that product, and then world-class sales associates. Because when customers come into the store, they really want to have an incredible experience. That's why they come to Neiman Marcus. And So we have to work at that every day. I don't think that there's any silver bullet, you know, glamorous answer to your question. I think it's day in, day out, making sure that we have great product and wonderful people who can build relationships with our customers. Our customers can go any place in the world to shop, and they don't need anything that we sell. And so it's all about enticing them with emotion and feelings and making them feel really good about their experience in the store.
How often do you communicate with your customers?
I guess you're not on our email list. I don't know, every day, every other hour, we communicate a lot.
And Carlos, same with you. I mean, are you in constant touch with...
Yes, more and more. I think that's one of the great things about this technology. If you really can connect with your customer more often, knowing exactly what they want more precisely than you in the past when you put an ad in a newspaper. Now it's much more of this one-on-one connection, and I think that customers expect this, you know, personally, this personally touch, this comprehension of what they really want. So I think we have to evolve using those instruments.
I think that's actually a key, is this personalization, especially through digital communication. Is, you know, obviously we push out emails to our customers on a daily basis, but the more personalized those are, the more they pay attention, because then they feel like we're speaking to them. And so I think that's a really important point.
So when you're personalizing them, is that personal according to their shopping habits? Do you call them by name? How personal do you get?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's all of the above. I mean, the analytics can help us get more personal, and then we have to have our sales associates who know them really very specifically, who can then personalize the emails, you know, and streamline them to specific outfits, to specific events they need clothes for. But I think it's kind of, you know, all of what you said.
Federico, same for you?
Yeah, we have trillions of data, no?
Yeah. Like,
and we can predict. I mean, we even launched a website coming from the data analysis. By founding after selling, I don't know, 10 million pair of shoes that women usually they buy, when they buy shoes, they buy only shoes. So we launched a website only made of shoes for women. So like, which is crazy, no, in a way, that you do like the biggest venture ever coming from this data. But again, I think that from like analytics, software, blah, you can like do amazing stuff. But at the same time, I really think that a human touch is so important. It's really so important. And sometimes it's a little detail. So like maybe like you do like with this search engine, blah, blah, blah. But then maybe, I don't know, you do a promotion and you tell the people that bought maybe 1 week before, sorry, like now the promotion is 10%. We give you the 10%, totally unexpectedly. And they are so happy. So something that you put in the package, I don't know, a note, thank you for this year, that it was a fantastic year. Mm-hmm. So something a little bit more human. Otherwise, technology can be very boring, can be a little bit alienating. Mm-hmm. So I don't believe in a model of a pure technology without any, let's say, sort of human interaction.
So you're with Iris on the like generation of robotic consumers?
No, I don't think so. Like, I mean, I agree with Iris, for example, when, for example, my daughter, she's very little, and she's not on the iPad, for example. And so she has a very strict British education coming from the mother. I think that it's not so, I mean, so radical. I've never been a fanatic about this or that.
But what about the question of privacy? Because I have to say, like, I'm one of those weird people, I guess, who when I go into a store, like, I don't want anyone to talk to me. I don't want anyone coming up to me and saying, like, can I show you 15,000 things? Like, I just want to look around by myself, and then if I have a question, I'll ask people for it. And often, if I feel too besieged in stores, I'll just leave. So how do you judge that? How do you know? How do you know if someone doesn't want many emails? They just want, you know, to get in touch with you when they want to get in touch with you.
Yeah, I think it's not easy. I mean, I think that it's training of our sales associates to make sure they know when to engage and when to stand off. And I think the same thing with email, you know, because people don't, once we get their email and we start emailing them, that most people don't opt out to not get our emails. They just don't. But we have to follow those kinds of things and understand who's opening our emails and who's not, and all of that comes in the data. But I think it's the combination of making sure our sales associates can, you know, sense, no, you want to look around, you know, you want to do it at your pace, not, you know, not guided by somebody.
Carlos?
Yeah, I think that, you know, we live today, and nowadays, I mean, technology is part of everyone's life. So no matter if what I think of myself, as I do, most of the people, they want to be reached out with all those, you know, all the social media, the things that use. I mean, I see a lot of people all day long, they're using this. And I think they're going to learn. I mean, sometimes it's a new technology, then you use a lot, and then you think that's too much. Then you learn to use, you know, in your advantage. So I think that's a learning curve. But you have to understand each of this technology and try to be very careful the way you use with your customer to really understand. But of course, we can commit some excess, you know, if when there's a new technology. But that's you know, modern life. I mean, it can go back. You're never going to go back. I mean, this generation, it's using this, and you're going to use even more. They're going to learn how to balance that. But so I think that you really have to understand how to manage that in a very balanced way.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I have one final question, and then we will take live questions from the audience. I'm struck by the fact that all of you mentioned fashion, art, and technology as being sort of the three key components of what goes into a good, successful store, whether it's online or offline. Do you agree? I mean, do you think that you need all three elements now to really create a luxury retailer, e-tailer?
I think we need anything that makes people to dream. And I think that I listen here, and I think art, technology, and fashion, and good products, they all make this, they have this same power. And I think so. That's why they combine very, you know, people have to be very creative. And sometimes it's even hard to follow their ideas, like the, you know, the Tom Sachs guy here, he was talking about mainly, I mean, it's hard to follow. But, you know, in a sense, you think that's a lot of sensibility. You dream about it. You want to build beautiful things. And I think fashion, art, technology, they can really put all those things together. So I think if you are able to understand and interpret what your customer wants through these elements in a good way, and you can execute in good quality, I think that you're going to be successful.
Yeah,
I think that's well said. I mean, I think the customer wants to be surrounded by beautiful things. That's certainly why they shop at Neiman Marcus and Bergdorf Goodman. And I think art is part of it. And technology is just another way to engage them in fashion and art at the same time. So,
Federico?
I think also, like, I would add maybe service, because I think it's super important as well. Otherwise, everything else looks, no, like you need some also foundations, and the foundations are the service. For example, we ship worldwide to 101 countries, over 3 million orders with 99.4% on time, which you wouldn't expect from an Italian company. Mm-hmm. But on these, we're a bit Japanese. And that's the ABC, no, the basics. And then I think also, like, also on service, you can be creative and you be entertaining also on service, like coming up with the, I don't know, Valentino.com, the initials, how to personalize your item just bought, as well as the butler service in China, you know, someone waiting outside of the door for 10 minutes while you try on the item, and you can give it back immediately without calling back. So like the Polaroid in the shoescribe.com, so the woman can put the Polaroid on the box. So also on that, I think you can be very, very, very creative.
Okay, I lied. I actually have one more question before I let anyone else look skinny. What about sustainability? You know, how important is sort of your own sense of your impact on, you know, on the world?
Very important. Because again, I mean, if you want to relate to your customer nowadays, you have to follow what the customers really want. And everybody, especially in Brazil nowadays, if there is a big sense of this issue of sustainability. And so if you really want to be connected to your customer nowadays, in with all the needs that they have, you have to address that. And as a company, you know, you have to move in that direction, otherwise you're going to lose your customer. So I think that for us, you know, it's not a matter, as a citizen, you have to do, because you live in your place, you have to realize that as a business person, you have to address those questions. Otherwise, you know, you'll be out of business sometime in the future.
So what are you doing?
We are in construction. We are taking care of all the issues related to that. I mean, when you think about, you know, the operational side, we're doing all types of things, treating sewage, I think. But we're doing all the stuff, you know, really, and we are engaging our customers more and more into that. You know, we feel that we are in so many communities around Brazil, and I think we have a responsibility to really even communicate and work with the local customer to address this issue. So we are doing that as a lot of our events and in the malls.
Mm-hmm. Karen?
Well, I think that we think about sustainability and at a little bit different level, because we think about how we serve our community. So sustainability is making the communities that we work and live in better, and that can come through the different tactics you use about recycling and how much energy you use and those kinds of things. But it can also extend to how we're supporting the community through our charitable giving, something we call All Heart at Neiman Marcus. Mm-hmm. And so we are very, very engaged in all of the communities we do business in, and I think it's a spectrum of many different things we do to make sure that we're supporting the communities in the ways that they need help and support from Neiman Marcus.
But I mean, do you agree with Carlos that it is a kind of integral part of connecting to, you know, the consumer, where you are?
I mean, it's part of our heritage at Neiman Marcus to do those kinds of things for, you know, well over 100 years. It's part of our DNA. So I guess we think of it probably a little bit differently than specifically sustainability. It's really about how we serve the communities that we live and work in.
Mm-hmm. Federico?
Yeah, it's also part, I think, of feeling good as an entrepreneur, no? Like, in a way. So, like, it's not only for the customer, but also, like, frankly, it's also for me.
All about you.
No, but for example, I give you an example, which I think it's sometimes I think since 3-4 years, all of our packages are eco and recycled with a stamp, like ta-ta-ta-ta. So for us and for all the other brands that we manage and we help to be online. And when you ship worldwide in a year 3-4 million packages, I think it's quite important. Mm. And we should convince more the big US giants, e-commerce, to do the same, because obviously it costs more, obviously, compared to not recycled. But if Amazon would do something like this, I think it would be a better world.
Okay. Olivia. How'd I know that was coming?
Well, I'm surprised that Federico didn't say the most important thing that he has done. Because you are a true innovator. You are the first major, one of the only one, I think, in the big online retailers that has dedicated an entire part of your retail to ethical brands with Yooxygen. So that is sustainability.
Thank you.
And my question was not why didn't you say it? I'll tell you off about that later. But do you have plans to expand that and to make it a bigger part of your e-platform, also to educate the consumer now that more and more brands are embracing ethical and ecological practices? Do you see expanding Yooxygen and maybe even making it an integral part of YOOX?
I think we launched Yooxygen, I think it was 2010. So it was 4 years ago, a little bit ahead of times, in a way, compared to other retailers. And actually, you have been on it happily from our side.
Mine too.
And we were expanding, so with the help of Amber Valletta, that now she's like kind of the curator of that part. It's doing well, but again, compared to the reason why I didn't mention it, because compared to 3 million packages going around the world, I think the impact of the 3 million packages making recycled, recyclable, and I think it's more impactful. And so I was just prioritizing given the limited time.
Okay, another question? Wow, okay, this gentleman, and then we'll take one more, and then unfortunately I think we have to go, sorry, to break because.
Thank you, this question's for Karen. I've long been a huge fan of Neiman Marcus. And it's because of the exceptional customer service that you do provide, the in-store experience. It seems to me that because of your unique position in that realm, that e-commerce presents greater challenges for you because you give up so much of the control over some of the end processes in that customer experience. Delivery can be unexpected. You don't have the salesperson right there to work with the customers. They open the box and try the garment on. I'd like to know, number one, what is the difference in your return rates, e-commerce versus in-store? And also, what kind of strategies do you have to make up for the lack of control over that customer experience at e-commerce and still provide what has become iconic Neiman Marcus experience?
Yeah, I think it's a terrific question. Our e-commerce business is a big, big business for us. It's, as I said earlier, almost 25% of our total business. I think that we're the largest luxury e-commerce business in the world. And so this is one of our highest priorities, is that the kind of service that we have become famous for over many, many decades in our stores, how can you have a similar kind of service experience through our e-commerce business? And it is, you know, kind of the beacon of light that we are trying to drive towards. And I think that we do many, many things to try to, bridge that, the kind of gap that you have between that interpersonal experience you have when you're in the store or when you're shopping online. But the fact of the matter is, our best customers like to do both. They love shopping with their favorite sales associates in one of our stores, but they also love seeing the vast array of, thousands of pairs of shoes at 11 o'clock at night, on their iPad when they're in bed, shopping. So I think it's really trying to bridge the experience so they do feel like they're getting a wonderful experience online. I think Federico, said this a little bit earlier, but it's the interweaving of engaging the customer online, whether it's their ability to watch a trend video narrated by Ken or seeing live streaming of fashion shows that we just saw in Paris, those kinds of things that you don't necessarily get in the store, but do engage the customer differently than with their sales associate. But I think it's one of the biggest challenges we have as both an e-commerce retailer as well as a brick and mortar retailer. Thank you for your business.
Okay, final question. Anybody over there? No? Okay, in the back.
Hi, this is also for Karen, one Dallas girl to the next. What's interesting is you talked about accessibility versus exclusivity. And I know that a few years ago, Neiman Marcus and Target joined together on co-production and co-distribution of products. And I'm curious, how did that work out for you? Was it successful? And if so, why or why not?
We thought at the time a terrific experience with Target. We always said that it was kind of one of those once-in-a-lifetime collaborations. And I think we took the best of the two companies. We also did it with the CFDA. So it was an alignment between the CFDA, Neiman Marcus, and Target, three companies that are all focused on great design. And that's what it was really supposed to be about, is bringing people who were like-minded and putting together a great selection of gifts at great prices and giving our customers something that was completely unexpected. And I think our customers responded very, very positively to it. And it was a great success at the time. And then we have to, as always, move on to whatever's next in our life. And we were very proud of that collaboration.
It is unfortunately time for us to move on. We're going to have a short break. Please join me in thanking the panel and see everyone back here at 3:30.